I am Dr. Romano, creator of the Dad Destroyer book. I'm here with my group tonight, and we're going to just do a little discussion on the stomach. Let's have a look. Now, what you need here, this is going to be for the MCAT, for the DAT, and the ODE exam. And then when you go to grad school, I think it'll help. What we're going to do is we're going to focus on this J-shaped pouch-like organ that's under the diaphragm in the upper left portion of the abdomen, and that's known as your stomach. As you can see here, I made a feeble attempt. I wish it was a benzene ring or a cyclohexane to draw. I can't draw, but I made a feeble attempt to draw the stomach. Notice the superior portion at the top is called the fundus. Further away, the distal is called the pylorus. So you should at least have an idea of when I say fundus and pylorus as far as position goes. Two main things that we want to make sure we understand for the DAT exam and ODE as well as MCAT. There's two little valves here, and I label them A and I label them B. A is the cardiac, or what we call the esophageal sphincter. And what it does, it prevents the backflow of the stomach contents into the esophagus. Don't forget, Goldstein, what's another name for esophagus?
The gullet.
The gullet, absolutely. You want to remember that. You knew that, or did Jonathan knew that? The next thing I want you to do is to look at the word, or letter B, pyloric sphincter. So in addition to the cardiac or esophageal sphincter is the pyloric sphincter. Another important question, that's going to prevent food regurgitation from the intestines back into the stomach. So we got these very important valves. You eat a bunch of food, it causes it to boil up, as you know, into a bolus. A bolus mixes with the digestive fluid, and that gives us the gastric juice, as you know. Now, when you mix the food bowl or food bolus with the digestive fluids, we make what's called chyme. Now, you should understand that the pH of the stomach is around 1.5. I call it 2 here to keep life simple. So that's not a definite number, but you get the idea. Very acidic. So the idea is to have an acidic stomach, it's going to kill most of the bacteria. And if you remember in the last lecture, we talked about denaturing proteins. The high acidity will denature proteins that are in the food. It doesn't self-digest itself though, because the stomach is lined with a mucus covering. Now, there's a few cells that I think you should be aware of going into the exam knowing, and we talked about most of these. For example, the parietal cell, that's for HCL secretion, and the intrinsic factor. If you remember, the intrinsic factor was involved in the absorption of vitamin B12. Oxyntic cells are also known as parietal cells. So you might sometimes see this word in grad school, oxyntic cells. These are the parietal cells. So remember, HCL and intrinsic factor. The chief cells contain the pepsinogen granules. Now this is a little tricky. That normally pepsinogen, that's not the active form of the protease pepsin. Now we're gonna get to this, but the important thing to know, this is the inactive form of the enzyme known as the zymogen. This zymogen, when HCL is present, it's gonna cleave off 42 amino acids. Not asking to memorize 42, but you get the idea. We're gonna modify, and when we modify it, we change the shape. And when we change the shape, we expose the active site. So that forms pepsin. So pepsinogen that's located in these granules of the chief cells is converted into pepsin. Here's where it gets a little tricky, that once it's made, that pepsin can auto-catalytically stimulate more pepsin to be formed. So once you form pepsin, it can come back and then activate pepsinogen. Now, mucous neck cells. Not goblet cells. You see a lot of textbooks call it goblet cells. That's in the small intestine mainly, but we call them mucus neck cells. So they're gonna make the mucus. And then the most diverse population that nobody ever gives any love to are the endocrine cells in the stomach. Now the endocrine cells include things like the G cells. Half of the population are the G cells, which make what? Gastrin. Gastrin is what stimulates the parietal cells. But you gotta be careful when you're hearing about the G cells because they're also made in the duodenum as well as the pancreas. So there's a few places that make G cells. D cells, we came across them if you remembered, in the pancreas. Here, they're also present in the stomach and they're involved in making somatostatin, which inhibits the gastric and the inhibition of intrinsic factor. Then we have two other cells that most students kind of forget about, but they're important. The enterochromaffin cells and the enterochromaffin-like cells. Enterochromaffin cells is involved in serotonin production, and the enterochromaffin-like cells are involved in histamine production. Two very small details that I don't think that you would likely see on the DAT, but I put it out there because you know I love overkill, and I love people that always talk about overkill, so we can end up smashing these guys. So the bottom line is, if you know this, I think you're set. We put a little overkill in there, so when you go to dental school, these are commonly asked board questions. All right, I hope this helps, and tonight we'll move on to plants and photosynthesis, and I wrote some new notes up. All right, bye-bye.